today is the annual general meeting of the Ladies of the Lake.
Oh, is that today?
She's their web person, so she
What's her name? What's her name?
Nancy.
Nancy, okay.
Yeah. But we put this together for a talk at the Ladies of the Lake, but it's been around for other meetings as well, our shoreline restoration project. We have got data going back. This is a watercolor in 1895, a very good one of the waterfront. Photographs starting about 1910 of the property, so it's a nice way of comparing things. Here is a 1913.
Oh, wow.
The old shoreline. Before there were really any cottages along this side of it, there were some along the point. And I've been trying to find exactly where some of these photographs were taken. Of course, the boulders move around every year. But we did a shoreline restoration project. Every cottage in here, and there's 17 cottages, had to fill out one of these. And we studied them through in a family meeting up here on top of the barn. And hired Peter Gill to do a, I don't know if people know him, to do a plan for us. And then the plan was okayed, I guess. Nancy is the one that did all this, so I know a lot less about it. And then hired ICES to do the work that was supposed to, that was okayed for the shoreline restoration plan, which here, which entailed, in one case, putting a drain into the lake. We'd like to have had a lot more than that, but it's too difficult to get permits. Then there was other work done to prevent flooding. Most of the work that they did along the shoreline, where people took down, in this case, an ice pressure ridge, you can see that a few years later, the push from the ice is building that ridge again. And then with wave action, the silt is carried out and the sand is carried out. So what they did is they moved the boulders, they put down filter cloth, then packed them back again. And now people are planting dogwood along here. And it seems to have been, this is one year when we did have an ice push back after the project was done. It seems to be holding fairly well. Here's another case where people removed everything from the shoreline. And here the ice came, they lose more and more feet of shoreline, of course. And again, was a job done with filter cloth and then putting the boulders back again. And again, dogwood was planted here. This was a massive ice push. You can see it here, building up a new pressure ridge again. And again, ICES put some filter cloth here and packed boulders in behind. So this was one of the projects that we're doing. We've got a managed forest tax incentive plan, which we just renewed to 2020, which involves the rest of the woods. There's about 90 acres here that is conservation land from our savanna. Tall grass savanna that with the help of MNR we're trying to rebuild. There's a portion of a wetland of provincial significance here, the Wilson Creek wetland. And we have the largest stand of red oak in Ontario. And we're trying to make sure that there's regeneration for these oaks. We also have one of the largest stands of healthy butternut in Simcoe County. And MNR has climbed, one of the largest butternut is about this diameter, has climbed to take little shoots, I guess, and to try and make new healthy butternuts out of them. It's a project, again, that seems to be going fairly well. What I'd like to do, and the rest of it, the rest of, so 90 acres, about 90 acres in conservation land, 18 acres is the shoreline, okay? On the conservation land, because of the tax incentive plan, we pay no tax. The rest is a managed forest, except for the 18 acres along the lakeshore. We pay full tax on that. But the rest is a managed forest, and for that we get we only pay 25% of the assessed taxes, which in that case is about $2,600. So the entire property away from the lakefront costs us about $2,600 a year. We've calculated what the tax savings are on that property, and we set that sort of aside to do the repairs that have to be done here, which at the moment are the most expensive repairs, is trying to provide drainage. These damn roads that were built through here without culverts are damming things up. Some of the large oak, the roots rot, they collapse. I could show you examples of that. And the other thing is that the telephone lines go on this side of the road, underneath the road, and you can only get a ditch so deep. Otherwise, Bell Telephone, they don't want to come and just relay all the telephone lines, because we want to get a deeper drainage ditch in there. But they're culverts that are filled with stuff that all have to be emptied, that are running across the roads to the rest of the property. 2 years ago, we had a plant survey done through this area by a botanist. She did a wonderful job, and she gave us a complete report on all of this, and with air photographs of what sections were most should be preserved and worked on most diligently. The dog standing barn started. There was a large patch that started on the other side of this grassy area. And nurseries.
Dog strangling vines.
Doing that without really knowing what you were doing. Here, this was all open. In here. You can see there some dead oak there. The very close.
Butternut tree.
They're on the endangered species list?
You've got some poison ivy here, huh?
Lots of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very allergic to it, but I've learned how to avoid it.
Yeah, you try to not step on it.
Yeah.
This was all sort of the old road, and it's
yeah.
been upgraded, so it's all happened quite
fairly
recently.
It's lovely the way they've made it.
Well, Innisfree's growing. There's no doubt about that.
I just wish the beach and the water was better. Very nicely done.
So hopefully this will.